This episode is a relaxing chat with four early career researchers from the School of Physics and Astronomy. In the beginning, we glance over the interesting areas in which their research is. Then we speak a little bit about how does one even become a PhD student or a postdoc. But later, we have a serious discussion about mental health, starting a family, and short-term contracts. We finish with their advice on what every undergraduate considering a PhD or a career in academia should know. I hope you enjoy listening. You're listening to Insight, the University of St. Andrews Physics Society's podcast. I'm your host, Veronika Sedláková. Join us as we journey through the lives of St. Andrews academics, discovering their passions, inspirations, and motivations. Hello everyone! Today's interview is quite special because it's with four researchers. It's with Ian Shand. Hi Ian.
Hello.
Rose Wall. Hi Rose.
Hi.
Viktor Notgren. Hi Viktor.
Hello.
And Dr. Kristin Björk and her daughter.
Hey.
Hi. Before we start, I just like to note that when we're recording this, the circumstances do not allow us to meet in person, so we are conducting this interview online. I would like to apologize to our listeners if the audio quality is lower as a result of this. Thank you for your understanding. And without further ado, could you tell me about your PhD / postdoc? And so basically what area is it in and what you're doing? What year are you in?
So I am in my third year of my PhD with Moira Gladden in astrophysics. So my PhD focuses on modeling the magnetic fields of low mass stars. So I spend a lot of my time behind my computer with simulations and avoiding real data at all costs.
That sounds incredibly fun. A lot of fun. Yeah. I mean, Viktor, would you like to continue?
Yeah, sure. So I'm in my third year as well of my PhD, and I'm doing it under the supervision of Natalia Kororkova. So it's in the area of quantum information. I've had two projects, really. One is on models of computation, so of quantum computation. And the other one is on entanglement among many parties, which, as in many places in physics, many means really three or more. But it sounds cooler when you say multi-partite.
It does sound really cool. I remember you once tried to explain to me and it was quite complicated, but let's leave that for later.
I'm also in my third-ish year of PhD, and my supervisor is Friedrich Koenig. So Viktor and I are actually flatmates, and both our supervisors are actually married to each other. So St. Andrews is a small uni and people can quite easily be connected. That's quite nice. So while Viktor does sort of more quantum information, I'm more in the field of quantum optics. I look at producing non-classical states of light in the lab. So for example, entangled photon pairs or squeezed beams of light. And so this involves a lot of the time being in a lab with no windows. But it's good fun.
Sounds like good fun. Yeah, yeah. And Kristin, you're the next stage in the evolution, basically.
Yeah. So I'm now doing a postdoc at St. Andrews, and I've been here for 2 years, so I guess I'm technically in my third year as well. And I'm working with two supervisors, Brendan Lovett and Jonathan Keeley. And so the things that I've been working on and like kind of brought up from my PhD and is still half focusing on that is strong light matter coupling or polaritonics, kind of these trying to model these systems where experimentalists have managed to confine light in a very small region and make it couple very strongly to some matter excitations, which leads to a hybridization of these states, which brings a lot of very interesting physics. And now I've started to move a little bit into a more general field of open quantum systems, which is modeling systems where we are not taking into account the whole universe, but we do know that some of the things we are describing can either escape or come back from the environment.
Yay, that does sound very fun. Do you have any other positions here in St. Andrews?
I guess I can say that I am acting as a contract research staff representative, meaning I go to both staff meetings in the school, in the School of Physics, and to represent postdocs, or go to staff research staff council to represent the School of Physics specifically in that. And then I've also been representing postdocs in the research council, where all the directors of research come together a few times a year. I've also been doing some tutoring and marking when I've had the time.
Wow, that sounds fun. Anyone else doing anything else?
Rose. I'm one of the PGR reps on the Equality and Diversity Committee. So I'm supposed to speak on behalf of all PGR on such matters. And I also help with the Panda magazine as well. So I guess they're my main roles. I have tutored in the past, but not in the online world. I've been freed of that responsibility this year.
Yay, okay. I was just wondering, why is that? If any of you know why suddenly I realize that it's mostly lectures during tutoring now.
I think so. Actually, I was doing tutoring last semester.
Okay.
And I know a few PhD students that are still doing tutoring.
Okay, sorry then.
Yeah, there are still some, I think. I guess if anyone has gone home and they're in a different time zone, there has been questions about whether that's actually feasible for people to take on teaching roles in that case. So,
I see. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Also, maybe people just didn't put themselves forward for it. I don't know. I know for me, I just felt like it was supposed to be my final year, and I didn't feel like the stress of learning to have to do everything online was something I wanted to take on. So I don't know. Perhaps other people also felt like that.
I see. Okay. And so you can actually offer yourself to teaching.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. I didn't realize it.
It's voluntary. You don't have to do it.
I see.
Well, you get paid. It's not voluntary, but you know, like you're not forced to teach.
I think it can be different in different universities, but here it's not mandatory.
I see. Okay. Yeah.
PhDs.
And sorry, Viktor, I interrupted you. Roles.
No. Yeah. You might have a sort of representative dense group. So together with Rose, I'm a postgraduate representative in the EDA committee as well. I've also done tutoring. I think most of us here have, but I'm not doing it now because I'm abroad. And if there is the chance that it goes into in person, then I think it's better if students can meet in person in the university. I've also been involved with the Buddhist meditation group. As I think it's secretary. I don't know the name of the role. I sort of do the organizational things. And as with Kristin, I've been involved with the Panda magazine.
Great magazine, by the way.
Yes.
And Ian?
Yeah, so I've done a mixture of sort of tutoring, lab demonstrating. I've also been involved quite heavily at various points with the SPIE chapter in St Andrews. That's been like a lot of fun. We've put on different events, different talks, invited speakers here, teas and wine socials, this kind of thing. So a lot of that is somewhat interrupted with the whole fact that we can't meet people now. But in principle, it's really good.
Yeah, well, yes. all right, now the ultimate question. Can you tell us more about your research, please?
I'll talk a bit about the multipartite entanglement project that I've been working on. In the broadest sense, it's related to the question of being able to infer properties about a large state when we only have access to a subset of all the parts of it. The scenario that I look at is with correlations between systems, quantum correlations, or entanglement in particular. So we look at or try to find systems that allow us to infer entanglement among all parties when we only look at subparts of it. So this project has also given the opportunity to work with another group in the Czech Republic, which has very nicely involved trips to the Czech Republic a few times in the eastern side. Very beautiful place.
It is. I can only recommend. cheap beer.
Yes, a very, very tasty one as well.
Definitely recommend. All modes, is the uni that you're working with?
Yes, that's the one.
I guess I've mentioned a little bit before with the light matter coupling or polaritonics or polaritons, which is that like these kind of structures that we can make where the light is coupling to some kind of material excitation. So my earlier work, I was looking at just semiconductor structures where everything is quite clean and neat. But since coming to St. Andrews, I've been focusing on organic molecules coupling to light. And organic molecules are a lot more kind of messy, and like they can vibrate, and you have like a lot more going on inside the material itself. So we've been trying to get methods that can kind of capture all of the physics of what is going on. And I've specifically been focusing on wanting to capture so finite size effects, saying that, because it's very easy often to say, okay, if we just say we have an infinite slab of whatever we make, or we have infinite number of molecules that are spread out in space, we get a lot of simplifications, but those simplifications aren't always correct if we have very small systems. So I've been, I guess my focus right now is trying to understand how the finite size of these systems impact the physics, and try to see what experimentalists might be able to capture in their experiments to show these effects.
That sounds fun. Okay, Rose, let's give Ian some time, I guess.
I guess most recently, I've just kind of come to the end of a project where I have been looking at modeling where prominences might form around very low mass stars. So prominences are essentially clouds of hydrogen that form on the sun, also on other stars as well. So I have a set of observations, scarily, of the surface of a few stars, and from that I can model what the magnetic field would be like all around the star, and use that to predict where these prominences might be. So I spent a long time trying to get the code to work.
Yeah.
And once I'd done that, it kind of was a lot quicker progress, as often is the case with research. And so I guess at that point, I kind of started to look at the similarities between the different stars and what I would be able to tell about these stars by knowing where these prominences were. So you could use them observationally if you observed that there was a prominence. That could also give you some information about what the magnetic structure of the star would have to have been. And observations of what the magnetic field is like, they only tell you about the surface of the star. So we kind of have to make some guesses when we model what it would be like further above the surface. So I guess they could be helpful as a kind of a feedback loop of telling us, yes, there was in fact closed magnetic field there or not. So they could be helpful observationally in predicting, I guess, how correct some of our models are. Yeah, it's fun.
By the way, why scarily the observations? Why is that scary?
I hate anything that is real. I like maths and
yeah.
Yeah, you know?
Yes.
I like calculus. I don't like data. So
real
observations give me the heebie-jeebies.
I see. All right. Okay. The hour has come. Ian.
Yeah. So basically, in terms of my research, it's in quantum nonlinear optics. So with light, it can have a range of properties. So it can have different polarizations. It can have different wavelengths. And within that, it can have a very narrow wavelength distribution or a very broadband distribution. So in terms of quantum optics, two common types of light that you might see is photon pairs, where the two photons are entangled. And then you might see also much brighter states of light, squeezed states of light. So if you think back to some of the physics that you've seen, where you have sort of position and momentum, and there's a certain minimum uncertainty, and you can have sort of a circle. If you imagine you can kind of squeeze this circle and you can have more uncertainty in either your position or your momentum. So light is very similar like this. So for example, you can have uncertainty in its amplitude, uncertainty in its phase. And squeezed light is essentially if you have a higher degree of uncertainty in one of those variables and the other one sort of you've squeezed it below a sort of circle where they're sort of, where they have a minimum uncertainty. So the total area is a minimum, but one is smaller than the other. And so in a lot of the work that I do, I explore different types of light sources and different types of nonlinear media, like different crystals and fibers, which allow us to produce either entangled photon pairs or squeezed states of light. We're interested in tailoring, for example, the bandwidth of these states of light, for example, really, really broad band, in which case this gives us better timing resolution. We produce these different states of light and they have, for example, very wide bandwidth. This can be good for things like interferometry.
So you're basically, you said what you're doing, you're in the lab and there are no windows and you're playing with lasers, basically.
Yeah, essentially, that's a very good summary of what I was trying to convey.
And it's also very smart.
Supposedly.
Anyway, one of my most favorite questions is, what was your path to your PhD / postdoc here at St. Andrews?
I did my undergrad in St. Andrews. I did my high school like 20 minutes away from St. Andrews.
Well, you're very much local.
Yeah.
Wait, did you like the local area so much that you just wanted to stay? Or why did you decide to do that?
So I applied to a few different unis in my undergrad and for various reasons, St. Andrews seemed like a really good choice. And when I was here, I really enjoyed the small department. I think it was really amazing being able to integrate with staff and really get to know them. And I thought it was really good, a good level. The teaching was really great. And there's a good community and you're treated well. I kind of seemed like a really great place to stay. I decided that I wanted to explore the option of academia, and sort of a PhD was like the natural next step, so I kind of jumped and went for it.
Great. Rose, what is your path to your PhD here in St. Andrews?
Well, I went to high school in the Highlands of Scotland. In the middle of nowhere. I mean, yeah. Not quite, but I had a chemistry teacher who had a PhD, and I was really inspired by that, especially as she was a woman. So that kind of got me thinking about that might be something that I would like to do, because I was very into science and obviously not research at that point, but I was very into finding stuff out, I guess. Despite that, it was actually physics that I was more interested in. So I betrayed her and went to study physics at undergrad. I knew even then that I hated lab work, in physics, at least. I did quite enjoy it in chemistry, but I hated physics lab work. I was never any good at it, and I have a horrible memory from undergrad of breaking the laser experiment to the point where there were four people around me with PhDs in laser physics who couldn't fix my experiment, and it was mortifying. So I actually chose St. Andrews because I could do theoretical physics and reduce the amount of lab work that I had to do. So that was how I ended up at St. Andrews. And that was kind of the end of my ability to cope with real data that you have discovered so far. I really loved my undergrad. Well, I guess I had a love-hate relationship with it because I felt exhausted all the time and worked too hard, but I really enjoyed the physics aspect of it. So I wanted to do a PhD, and I really enjoyed the courses, the solar physics or solar theory, I think it was called, the maths course, and fluids. I decided to do my final year project with Moira, even though I was a theoretical physicist and she is technically an astronomer, although there is a lot of crossover. There is no reason to feel like just because you're doing theory or, you know, just because you're doing astro, you can't branch out and try other things, because your skills are still applicable elsewhere. So that was kind of what got me into realizing that even though I hated electromagnetism, I quite liked stellar magnetic fields. So that was how I ended up here.
Yay. That sounds fun. And so the transition from sort of doing a theory undergrad to doing a astro PhD, was that smooth, or did you have to study something extra, or how did that work?
So normally, I think it's true at most universities really, but I can only obviously speak for St. Andrews. If you're doing a PhD, you're required to take a certain amount of taught courses. So for me, the logical thing to do was to take like the undergraduate taught courses for astro in St. Andrews as a PhD student. And so I think most people do like super courses, but for me, the background in astro was obviously not necessarily the equivalent of a lot of kind of my peers, I suppose. So I took a few taught courses, and also, you know, a lot of it is physics that you already know. Like, you might not know the facts, but the problem solving you already have. So you can pick the facts up. There's no, you know, everyone has to learn stuff in their PhD. It's not actually that that different. And also, you know, you can tutor courses and you learn a lot before you teach stuff. So, no, it wasn't smooth, but I don't think it's smooth for anyone. I mean, it wasn't horrendous.
Okay, that sounds nice, yeah. How about you, Viktor? What was your path to St. Andrews? Yes. Was it your destiny?
Yeah, exactly. So I was trying to think, like, was there one sub? I liked school in general. I liked sort of like finding out about things and like how useful knowledge was as well. Mm-hmm. I think a thing, I was born in Bolivia and moved to Sweden when I was about 10. And I think a thing that sort of helped me in my path was that because everything was taught in Swedish, or I was in a school to learn Swedish, the course that I could sort of continue exactly as before, apart from English classes, was maths. It was like basically the same thing. I needed to learn just a few things, but apart from that, it was just doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. So I think that helped me like stay within that. I also like to argue, but I find arguing with symbols, it's easier for me than arguing with words, which made it sort of like easier to continue to like natural science rather than social sciences. So I sort of kept mostly maths or mathematics and natural sciences in school. I quite liked physics because it seemed to be the one that you needed less sort of like bulk knowledge. you could derive more things from it, which I find sort of quite neat. So I did my undergraduate in Glasgow because I wanted to study somewhere in English, and my sister had moved to Scotland before me, so it was also easier to sell it to my mom that I would be moving somewhere else.
Yeah, that can be difficult.
Yes. I ended up doing a project in quantum mechanics, or I quite like quantum mechanics also because of the sort of like how it's built up from quite simple axioms and really not many. It's sort of like clean and pretty, at least at sort of undergraduate level. So I did a project with the quantum group in Glasgow, which was really fun. And I found the project, or they had recommended me the group here in St. Andrews. And the project seemed really interesting, so ended up here.
Yay! Cool. And also, I think that arguing but with symbols is probably one of the best descriptions of maths I've heard. Okay, yeah. And Kristin, how about your path to St. Andrews?
So my path started in Iceland, where I'm born and raised. So I did an undergraduate degree in physics in the University of Iceland. Then I kind of knew that I wanted to go further. I wasn't done with physics, so I wanted to continue, but I wanted to go abroad and get more experiences. So I went to Sweden, to Stockholm University, to do a master's in theoretical physics. And during that time, I started working with actually a professor that had taught me in my undergrad, which was working with polaritons or light matter coupling. He had a position in Iceland and in Singapore, and was in Sweden for a meeting, and where I met him, where he offered me to do the master's project with him. So I ended up jumping on that. And when I was then finishing that project, he offered me a position, a PhD position in Singapore, in Nanyang Technological University. So I took that, and because I was really enjoying the work, and I was very, very excited about going abroad, going so far away, and still having the opportunity to having the connection home and being able to visit home through a like kind of collaborative ways of visiting kind of officially the university. So I did my PhD in Singapore. The funny thing is that actually the supervisor I started with ended up leaving his position in Singapore while I was doing my PhD because he got another position in his home country, Russia. I ended up, so I moved supervisors to, a local new professor that had been a postdoc in the group when I had started. So I finished my PhD with him in Singapore. And while finishing my thesis and finishing up some of the work that I had been doing at the end of my PhD, I was looking for postdoc positions. I applied for quite a few, and it never felt like anything quite fit. I had some interviews that went well, but I wasn't quite sure how it was going to go. But then a friend of mine was visiting and brought up, it's like, hey, did you know that the Jonathan Keeling in St. Andrews is looking for a postdoc? And I was like, wait, that name sounds familiar, but I don't really know. So I started looking into it, and I was very excited about what the project was about. It was just the right amount of things that I had already been working on and some new things of like interesting new physics because I wanted to add to my skills. And I was very impressed by the work that Jonathan had been doing. So I applied, and I think it's like within a month I was offered the position and was getting ready to move to Scotland. That position was only 1.5 years though, but during that time, me and Jonathan worked quite well together, and then I got to know Brendan Lovett as well. And they ended up getting a grant to hire a postdoc. So I, after 1.5 years on the original project, I moved to the group of Brendan Lovett as well as with Jonathan to work kind of on another project, which all of that. I guess it was quite lucky because that contract started in the middle of the first lockdown. So I'm very happy that I ended up getting this extension, or else I would have had to be moving countries probably in the middle of a pandemic, which would not have been nice. But I'm very happy here. I'm very happy working with the people I'm working with. I think the department here is excellent. So I'm happy. And I have 2 more years of my contract here. We'll see how it goes after that.
That sounds incredible. Wow, what a journey. Won't it be strange when we're all falling? skipping quickly to the next question, a bit fun one, I suppose. Do you have any hobbies? What do you like to do in your free time?
What is free time with a toddler and a puppy?
Okay, well, a puppy counts like a free time. Any stories with a puppy? Any stories with a puppy or a toddler? I should be more happy about babies than puppies, I suppose.
Well, we took them to the beach the other day, and my partner managed to keep the dog dry while dropping the toddler in the sea, which I felt was the wrong way around.
I can imagine. That was very helpful.
My life is somewhat chaotic right now, but I don't know. I guess normally hobbies would be like running and reading and playing computer games, but I don't currently want to spend more time in front of the computer than I have to. That one is currently kind of off the table.
Yeah, that is very relatable, honestly. Sorry for forcing you spending time in front of a computer.
For me, I also like playing video games, but that is very on and off right now, especially with so much time in front of the computer that sometimes you feel like you want to do something else or just be in another part of your home. But I do like to go hiking as well. I don't go as often as I would like to or should, but I guess I can call it a hobby.
Mm-hmm. Any favorite place here in Scotland?
I have to look up. There was a very nice... I really should go to more places in Scotland, but I've once been to like Airgorns.
Mm-hmm.
It was so beautiful there, and I was also just very lucky with weather.
Uh-huh.
I feel like no matter where you go in Scotland, especially if you're lucky with weather, you're probably going to enjoy it.
That's very true, actually. Yeah.
But I guess with the lockdown, I've been also picking up hobbies to do inside. I've been knitting a lot, and I've been quite productive so far in the last year. And I started playing the ukulele.
Oh, wow.
That's an overview of my hobbies.
Yeah, that sounds good fun. How about you, Viktor?
So I've been playing more guitar. Well, I'm closer to one while I'm working.
Yes, so people can't see this, but yeah, we can basically see Viktor, a white wall, and a guitar on the wall. So. Sorry about that.
No. There's another one here on the side as well,
there's another hidden guitar, turns out.
I bought a like a pedal with loops. It's really fun.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I guess that's part of a hobby. And now that I've been, so I don't think I said, so I'm in Sweden at the moment, where some of my family lives. So I've been able to spend more time with my siblings, which is a great bonus of the whole pandemic. So we've been doing different things with them there from 8 to 14 years. We're actually planning an escape room with a middle one. It's really exciting.
That sounds fun. Wow. Okay. But like, if it involves a multi-level quantum system, so what was it?
that will be one of the puzzles for them to solve.
Yeah.
Solve my PhD for me.
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, you will not escape from here.
Yeah. You never know. You may get good insights.
Well, yeah. Any hobbies? Any free time?
Yeah. Well, currently, a big thing is plants for me. So both indoor and outdoor, I have a lot of plants. My flatmate has not been here during the pandemic, and I've slowly been filling up his room with plants. But I don't know if he knows this, so I just thought I'd reveal this to him live on radio.
Just as much interaction.
Great. Yeah. And I planted some berries last year in the pandemic, so it was great. I got my autumn raspberries last year, and this year I'll get my summer raspberries that take like they need 2 years to grow. So that's going well for me. Other than that, I find it quite therapeutic doing powerlifting. just moving heavy objects and putting them back into the same place apparently can make you quite happy. So that is one of the ways I deal with my stress.
That is quite fun. Also, two very unrelated things, but yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I reckon some of his plants could be pretty heavy by now.
Actually starting to be a real problem. Some of them are like much bigger than I anticipated. Like they're getting pretty big.
Have you still got that tree that you rescued from our house?
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
I didn't know you rescued a tree.
What is this?
Well, it's a plant that turned out to be a tree.
Yeah.
Like it's really little. It was like in like a really, really small coffee mug shaped thing. But it turns out it's actually a tree. And I think it can grow like many, many meters tall. But yeah.
You can always take a bonsai.
Yeah, that would be cool. Mm-hmm. And if you have it for like 50 or 70 years, then it will be very valuable. You can sell it.
It could pay for your retirement.
Yeah.
Okay. Time for the favorite music genre and favorite song, maybe. Do you have any favorite songs or something that you currently listen to?
Sorry, can you hear the dogs in the background?
I was wondering if someone started playing the song or whatever.
I might have to mute myself if they come into the house making a lot of noise.
No, don't worry. Just since we're talking about that, what breed is your puppy?
Or what breed?
Or like sort of.
She's a 12-week-old Springer Spaniel. But my parents also have a dog, so who's like an 11-year-old collie cross lurcher. So he still thinks he's a puppy, which he isn't, as he's now discovering, but it's a lot of noise in the house.
That must be quite lively.
If it gets too loud, just tell me to mute myself.
Yeah, don't worry about that. Yeah,
that's to the ambience.
Yeah, it gives some real feeling to it, I suppose. Yeah,
working from home life.
Yeah, a view into our lives.
Yes. Anyway, how about the favorite song, Rose? Did you already figure out something?
It's always hard to pick a favorite song, isn't it? When people say, "Oh, what's your favorite song?" I don't know. I guess a classic that I have been fond of my entire life is Disco 2000 by Pulp. So I don't know what genre that is. Alternative rock, maybe?
No idea.
I don't know. But that's probably my favorite, I suppose.
Okay.
Sounds that it has, you know, lasted decades rather than being my favorite for 2 weeks and then never played again.
I see. Okay. Good. Kristin?
Yeah, so I like to listen to all kinds of music, and I don't really know much about like necessarily what genre things are, but very often things that are called alternative are often quite nice. But I also like more indie, rock, hip hop, electronic things. Experimental things are nice. But I guess if I have to pick one song, I've been listening a lot to a recent album by like a singer songwriter called Briet, which is Icelandic. And I guess I will give you a song in Icelandic from that, from her newest album. And the song is called Roller Kuregi, or Easy There Cowboy. It's a very good song, I think. It's like a slow kind of half love song, half breakup song, I guess.
Uh-huh. Sounds fun. Wow. Okay, thanks for that. Sounds interesting. Okay, and Viktor, do you know yours?
So I guess like during my teens, I listened quite a lot of metal, which will not be what I'm recommending now. It's like sort of, I don't know, you can go into like tons of subcategories, but like black metal and folk metal were the ones that I sort of listened maybe more to. I don't know. I like somewhat broad, whatever broad means. Recently, I've been listening to, I've been finding myself going to one called Halftime. I don't know if it's hers original. It's Amy Winehouse who sings it. Hope you enjoy it.
Yeah, well, I hope so. So far, our recommendations have always been great. So Really interested. And Ian, do you know your favorite music genre and song?
This is like such a broad question, and my answer oscillates in time. it's a non-stationary solution. Well, I like everything from sort of classical music to heavy metal to jazz to dance. There's so many amazing things. This is pretty hard. I think today I'm feeling in the mood where I'm going to pick the band Placebo for their staying power. They've been a very good band that I've loved a lot since I was a kid. And the song I'm going to pick is their cover of Where Is My Mind? Because I often ask myself that question, but it's super chill and yeah, I like it a lot.
Okay, some approval here. That sounds interesting. Anyway, going to the more specific questions where I'm just interested in your answers. So I'm thinking, what are your thoughts on moving from academia to industry? Anyone having thoughts on that? Because that's something some PhD students want to do.
Victor? I think it can be a great idea. I think it depends person to person. I think you need to analyze the kind of the stage in life you are, what you want from life, the hours you want. And I think independent of what career path you take, there's certain things that make a big difference. For example, what your relationship is with your boss. That can be either good or bad in both academia or industry. You may have like additional like financial considerations, job stability, this kind of thing. And so I think there's not necessarily like a one size fits all. But there's a lot good in both of those. And so I would just almost be like, make sure you're kind of making the decision for the right reason, as opposed to like, there's something wrong and I need to change it. And be aware that like, it may be something that's like fundamentally does or doesn't work with academia or industry, or it may just be your specific version of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I'll add to that, as someone that has obviously chosen at least straight after my PhD to not go to industry, but to stay in academia, I think it is important that even if you decide to stay in academia, that you don't do like you don't completely close the door to academia because you know, close the door to industry, because academia can be difficult. You have short-term contracts, and depending on where you are, you can have like pretty negative or toxic environments, and you have to be willing to stand up for yourself and willing to put boundaries. And if things aren't working out, if you aren't getting funding to stay on, if you are getting tired of having to move all the time because you get short-term contracts, it's important to kind of value yourself enough to be willing to say, no, this is enough. I'm going to go to something more stable. And even if you do end up staying in academia, you should keep in mind that, yeah, you should put yourself first and not just keep doing academia because it feels romantic or something like that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's also hard because obviously you're asking people who, you know, the rest of us aren't postdocs and we haven't had that like next step in the career ladder of academia, but we're still kind of quite institutionalized in the sense of having, you know, stayed on in academia and not having necessarily had industry experience. And I guess following on from what Ian was saying, it's quite easy to think the grass is always greener or kind of, I don't know, idolize the other one rather than being aware that, you know, I agree with Kristin, you definitely need to be aware that you should be keeping that door open, but it doesn't necessarily mean that that path is perfect either. I think it's quite difficult for us to, I suppose, give a balanced answer to that question because we don't have the industry experience, I suppose, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I agree.
So I can give some sort of like personal thoughts, like compared to the more generic things that people think that are probably more useful. So I'm thinking after my PhD of going, I don't know if I would call it industry. So going into either what's it called, NGOs or like non-governmental organizations or civil service type work, which I guess is some sort of industry. It's sort of like it comes for two reasons. One is what Kristin said, that stability, that like I think I'm valuing stability a bit more at this stage. Well, it's not necessarily that it's not stable, but that sort of like moving to places and applying for grants, which can be like maybe something that people might enjoy parts of, but something that's sort of necessary to do. But I think more importantly for me, it's sort of a line of thought that has been important, like outside of the particular work that I've been doing, is in terms of like the effects that systems that it's like somewhat philosophical, because I haven't really sort of thought about it like in too much detail. The ways that systems that we use affect us, like either sort of large societal ones, but also ways of working, say, or like working with others. So I don't know, some examples, like at a personal level, it can be like meditation or cognitive behavioral therapy, which is sort of like seeing ways of thinking and how they can go wrong. But also contact tracing now with a pandemic, or even like cake cutting, how can you cut cake such that like you minimize the feeling of what's it called when someone gets more than you, whatever that sentiment is. So while there are very interesting questions that you can ask in physics, or like with the tools that you get in physics, I find that now there are like these other questions that I'd like to tackle. So in that sense, it's sort of like for me, while I'm looking before I get a place, like finding somewhere that is still interesting, sort of intellectually, but just that it's a different area of questions, which I think I can like maybe find somewhere else. And I'm thinking that in terms of education for people who are listening here, I think physics can be give you a good grounding for these things. Because like what we do is many times like model a physical system and see how it behaves, and sort of like do changes. Even though I need to complement my studies and my work with a few other courses, I think it can be a good foundation. As Rose said though, like this is before picture. The answer might be different once I'm post this.
No, but that sounds really interesting, and it's also like very fascinating. And hopefully, good luck with that.
I might be just thinking of like, what do you say? Not pink, like green tinted glasses that I'm wearing at the moment.
Well, let's see. I mean, and it's also great to hear that like physics can actually equip you to do all these things and answer all these questions. We've been told that. But yeah, it doesn't hurt to hear it again. It's useful.
Yeah, from I guess like I can add from like careers, fairs, and so on. There seems to be a sense that they hire people from physics, so there's like a bit of real world data.
Great. Okay. So since we've spoken about that, I was wondering if someone would like to speak about how it is, what is it like to move to a different country to study / start a research project / whatever.
I guess I have quite extensive experience with that now that I have actually moved three times to Sweden, to Singapore, and to Scotland. I have a theme going on, if you hadn't noticed.
Next time is Sri Lanka.
Yeah, I have to make a short list of where to go next. But I would say, like, I guess, like, in one sentence, it's both exciting and terrifying, I guess. Or, like, it can be difficult, and it definitely... It is a lot of work to go to a new place, having to learn how everything works, having to make new friends and everything. And I think for some people, that is something that gives people energy. For others, it might just sound too daunting. So I think it depends a lot of your kind of personality. But you can also kind of just tailor the experience to what you want to get out of it. But it is important to keep in mind that it's going to take time and like mental energy to set yourself up. And so you have to be kind to yourself also, that you might not, especially now moving into a postdoc here, I kind of felt like, yeah, okay, now I have a PhD, I'm supposed to know how to do research. And then like my first month here, I did basically nothing because I was just like getting introduced to people, figuring out like where I wanted to live, what I wanted to do, how I wanted to set things up. And I think that's normal. And everyone around me was very flexible with that, so it was fine. But I at least enjoy it quite a lot. So I feel like 3 times might be enough for now.
I can understand. But it's still, would you say it's worth it?
Definitely. In my experience, it has definitely been worth it. And I do think that most people I've met would probably say that it would have been worth it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I concur. So I moved to Scotland for my undergraduate from Sweden. As Kristin said, like, there are some difficult bits that everyone goes through. Learning codes, also just like renting and things like that. I guess that for me was new anyway, so maybe I haven't seen like that many changes in different continents. It's really given as well. You learn about yourself, your own culture, and about different places too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a very good point that I think I've learned more about my own culture than I realized, because there are so many things which you just assume is normal, and then you meet people that do it differently and you're like, wait, what? Like, it was a decision to do it like I was doing it before. I didn't realize.
That is very true, yeah. It is good fun. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. What is it like doing a PhD and having a family?
I feel targeted.
Sort of.
I guess I can only speak from my experience, right? And that's definitely not going to be the same for everyone. It's going to be very dependent on probably your funding body. It's going to be dependent on your supervisor. It's going to be dependent on the school, etc. I was very lucky. I'm funded for my PhD by STFC, which is a UK research council. So I was eligible to have quite a lot of maternity leave. So that obviously is helpful, which I'm going to say shared with my husband, but he took the vast majority of it. So it was very much not equal sharing. The school were very supportive of me, as was Moira. It probably helps that I felt like she understood kind of what I was going through in a lot of cases, including at certain points in pregnancy being unable to concentrate on anything. Mm-hmm. And she was very understanding of that. It's hard at times, especially right now in a pandemic when he is at home all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But personally, I think it was the right choice for me. I wanted to give myself the option of doing a postdoc afterwards. And I felt that for me, it would be easier if I'd already had a kid beforehand, mm-hmm. rather than starting a postdoc and then maybe feeling like I wanted to start a family. I felt like it was just easier rather than, I don't know. Sometimes it feels easier to bring a kid along with you than it does to start the process, I guess.
No, I can very much understand. It is difficult to time manage, isn't it? Sort of.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I felt that I had a lot less responsibilities. You know, I'm responsible for my PhD and that's kind of it, really. I mean, that's on me if that doesn't go quite well, or I didn't spend as much time on that as I should. Whereas I guess I had the worry that I had more of an obligation to work once I started doing my postdoc, if that's where I end up. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah, I guess it's yeah. hard, but time management is probably difficult for everyone with a small child.
No, yeah, sorry. I was more thinking that it might be a bit difficult for women to like to put together all these short-term contracts and having a child and maternity leave and keeping in this work process.
I guess I can't fully answer. I don't. I mean, I guess that wasn't a question, but I can't fully answer that. But I also had the same worries that. If I were to take time out, then it would be potentially more detrimental to my career than now. Whether or not that's true, don't know. And I think people have different opinions on that as well. Hello, do you want to come and say hi? Speaking of which.
Yes.
Yeah, come on then.
Okay, this introducing Oliver. Hi.
Hi, Oliver.
Hi.
Hi.
Hiya, will you tell us anything?
You're a lot quieter than you usually are. Can you say some words? His first word was star. Yeah. Stick. That's not a stick.
The new favorite word.
He's trying to explain to us he wants a wand, like with a stick and then a star in the end. He's like, star, yeah. Stick.
I know. It's so many people all at once. It's I promise I won't be long.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Sorry about that.
I mean, it was my fault.
No, it was.
It was the right time for me, I think, so.
Okay.
And his first word was star, which is obviously a success in parenting, I think.
Yeah, definitely. It's following your determination now. Beautiful. Cool. Any more thoughts on family and academia?
I feel like Kristin can maybe, I don't know, are my fears correct?
I do think that, like, I think it makes sense what you're saying. I think it's going to, like, if you're in your postdoc, it's probably going to depend a lot more on where you are, like, your surrounding at that time. And luckily, the UK is quite good. Like, most of the UK research councils are very flexible with maternity leave and things like that. But it is still, yeah, like, it feels more time sensitive of, like taking a half a year or a year off to ask maternity leave. Like, you will see it more clearly in the CV, so you might have to explain it, and then it's going to depend on the person reading it, do they take it as a negative or a positive or not. And but while in your PhD, like, in the end, the only thing that matters about your PhD is the year you graduate. Like, that's kind of the clock starts then when you're, like, looking at the career. So I think it was a very good decision to do it before you end your PhD. And just, yeah, like, moving the end date of your PhD 1 year later is not going to change anything, I would say.
Mm-hmm. I mean, whoever thinks that a maternity leave in a CV is a bad thing doesn't deserve to have you as a student.
Yeah, you probably don't want to work in that place anyway, though. But
yeah, probably.
And then I do think that, yeah, like, it depends a lot on the surrounding. And I think that, like, in the UK, there's been a lot of push of being more flexible to people taking leaves off for any kind of reasons related to this, like both maternity and paternity, or if you have to just care for a family member or something. And I've seen quite a lot of, like, fellowships and bigger grants that when you're applying, they always look at, like, how long has it been since you graduated. But then there is normally the option of, like, and if you had a career break, you can explain it here, which makes it look like they are taking it into account, which is nice.
It is nice. You can't imagine how relevant this is to me. I'm sorry to mention this. Too much an issue for most undergraduates yet. But, like, I'm getting married next summer to a guy that's much older than me. And also it's like, yes, thinking, like, at which point to start a family is like a puzzle. Like, when, how do I, like, fold this around?
Yeah.
So just asking for some opinions and experiences.
Yeah.
I think especially if you have, if your PhD supervisor is understanding, then I think that's the perfect time probably to do it.
Oh, yeah. Well, looking at Rose being so tired right now, I'm not sure, but yeah.
I hate to break it to you, but you're going to be that tired regardless. So, like, I don't know. I feel like I feel significantly older than I did last year. And I don't think that's entirely due to Oliver. I think that's also, like, I don't know. You start reaching a point where you can't just live off pizza and not exercising. And it kind of, well, it hit me in my mid-20s that I was actually starting to, like, age. So I think, like, being tired all the time when you're younger is easier to bounce back from.
Any comments from the guys here?
So I broke up with my then partner at the beginning of my PhD, so, like, thinking about family seemed a bit further fetched.
Oh, well.
I haven't thought about like raising a kid by myself. But like, of course, there's the, like, as Rose was saying, like, age is somewhat important. So my mother was quite young when she got her first kid. And my sister was sort of not old, but like older when she got her first one. And my mom has like reminded us how big a difference it seems to make just for your energy. I'm not very young. So I think it's still a thing. Obviously, like I think there's less pressure sort of like biologically for men in terms of having families, but there's still, I don't know, somewhere there.
Yeah. Yeah. Considerations in the back of your head. Yeah. Mm.
I just wanted to tie it back to like to that idea of stability as well in terms of job. Also, obviously, both with the like family that I have, siblings and so on, but also the narrower meaning of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I also was thinking of your comments of you know stability and stuff. Obviously, being younger, I think in some ways is helpful having a family, but also you tend to have less money and things like that. You tend to not have your own house. So like, obviously that's not as helpful. Like there are positive and negatives to whenever you have a family. There is never a right time to have a family. There is just a time that you think is okay for you.
That is a good way to put it, I think. That's good. Well, we've already sort of touched on like some more serious topics, but this is, I think, the next quite serious one is I found an article in which I read that over a third of PhD students in the UK are at risk of mental health problems like depression or anxiety. And so I was wondering if any of you ever had concerns about your mental health, or if you have any idea on maybe why this number is higher than for the general population.
Yes, if I can start by answering the second question, like why this number is so high. I think that there is a big thing that needs to be like taken into account, that doing a PhD tends to be hard. It tends to be that you're really pushing yourself. You're doing something that you're probably not good at to start with, like doing research, being surrounded by people that seem to know so much. And very often PhD students are people that are used to being good at school, and then suddenly you feel like you know nothing. So there is this kind of pressure and maybe feeling the competitiveness of like feeling like you don't know enough, which leads to imposter syndrome, which I think the majority of people that I've talked to that are doing or have done a PhD deal with imposter syndrome, of having this feeling of everyone knows so much more than me. So I must be doing something wrong. I don't belong here. But as I say, most people do feel like this. So hopefully they can get over it. But I do think that is definitely something that doesn't help. For like me personally, I will mention that like during my PhD, I ended up developing and then being diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder with secondary depression. And which was very hard, and especially doing something that is difficult. And I think so the trauma was not related to the PhD at all. So a lot of the mental health issues were not related to the PhD, but I definitely think that it didn't help, like being away from my family, living on the other side of the world, being in a situation where like my research project wasn't working very well. I was like not sleeping well, and I was stressed over my work. And then having to go through mental health issues on top of that, I think makes it even harder. So it's definitely something that I'm very aware of. And I do try to reach out to the people around me to make sure that they are okay. Because also like me personally, like I was really struggling for a time, and I just felt like I didn't have the time to relax. I feel like I didn't have the time to get help, and that just speaking out was just like I should rather be using my time doing something else, trying to figure out my project and trying to get things to work, and I should just stop whining. But then, yeah, finally I ended up kind of breaking down, reaching out for help, and now I feel like I'm completely fine and completely over it. But it's something that I have to be careful with, of taking care of myself, taking time out for myself, and setting boundaries. Of sometimes you have to put some time for yourself, no matter how you that you feel that you always are so close and or always are so far away at the same time.
I mean, wow. Thanks for sharing that. And also great, really great job that you managed to get over that. And wow.
Yeah, I think sort of like adding to some ideas, I don't know how much insight I have for the second part, but like why this number is higher. But I guess like for myself, a thing that changes quite a lot, apart from what Kristin was saying, that you end up with people that are good at what they are, and people that seemingly are doing better than you are, whatever that comes. Then I think like two extra things. One is this idea of better, that it's extremely badly defined, that you use yourself to gauge your sort of current state, which is quite easy to, that it ends up to like quite bad habits of thinking. And another one, it's also like the way that you progress. An analogy I've used, I don't know where I've heard it, is so like during your undergrad, you're like cycling on asphalt. So it goes quickly, you get a lot of new information. Then when you start getting onto like producing knowledge yourself, you like get into the like cycling on sand, and it's you need to pedal harder and you advance a bit slower. Which sort of coupled to this comparing yourself with this like idealized goal, I think can be also a damaging one. I wasn't diagnosed. I assume it would be primary depression during my PhD as well. Once again, I can't blame the PhD fully for that, but it's also a thing that sort of added stressors doesn't really help that. And as Kristin said, like one has to be wary of when to take time to work on oneself. Because like, mm-hmm. Yeah, there are different ways of tackling it, which I don't think I'm qualified to speak of.
Yeah. Well,
but seek help, I guess, would be the only thing.
Absolutely.
A little bit what Viktor and Kristin have both said is that if you're suffering from a mental health condition, often it can take a certain amount of time to heal. And I guess if you think of like a physical injury, in order for it to heal, you need to sort of not overload it and put too much pressure on it. And I guess with academia, so for example, if you're suffering from poor mental health, it may impact how well you're able to perform. And then if each day you're kind of not performing as well as you might like, it adds a lot of pressure. In a similar way that like if I was to work as a builder and I had a sore arm and I had to keep building each day, the act of building would intensify the difficulty with healing that. And I think that if you kind of think about sort of useful environments for healing things like this, it's there's maybe a lot of challenges. So for example, there's no rhythm necessarily to your work of like you needing to be in at a certain time. You also can't, it's not as easy to turn off and be like, okay, I've done my day's work and now I can go and have some time off. So I think that if you're already facing a lot of mental challenges, the PhD can be sort of extra hard in a sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes lots of sense actually, yeah, I'm sure. Thank you so much for sharing these insights. I feel like we need to... insights. I feel like we maybe need some more positive question, if you agree with me now. What are the good things about doing being an early researcher and doing a career in academia or doing a PhD and then maybe switching to something else? But like, what is the good side of this?
There are none.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that there is I think there's a lot of really amazing things. So obviously I'm just doing a PhD, I'm not doing postdoc or anything like that, so I can only talk about my experience so far, but I think it's a really amazing opportunity to sort of develop and grow, just find out more about yourself as a person, find out more about like a really interesting research topic. I think as well, there's lots of like additional courses you can take to sort of be like having good time management, having good like sort of planning of a big project, having good writing, this kind of thing. And not to say I actually implement most of the things I learned, but it's a slow process. And I think over time you do get slightly better. And I think, so for me, what I try and focus on is it's a bit of a journey, and you kind of pick up these tools, you explore these new things. I think you meet a lot of really, really amazing people, and you kind of see, okay, I'm not entirely sure what the next step might be, but I'm kind of taking these things and they're a next stepping stone for me. That's what I think so far. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, if I can add something to that, the very fact that you don't have a 9-to-5 job, and so if we decide that we want to go cycling tomorrow in the morning together, then we can. That's good as well.
I'm always working. I don't take casual data, but yeah. I think you're exactly right. So you do have a good degree of flexibility. That is something that is really amazing, and a lot of jobs would not have.
Mm. I have to say, like, when your research kind of comes together, like, you spend so many days, sometimes you spend the whole day, you feel like you're staring at a wall, or you spend the whole day trying to code to find the one mistake, and then there was a minus in the wrong place, and it feels frustrating. But then when it actually falls together and you make a plot that is so beautiful and it fits what you feel like should be there, or it's giving you some new insight, that feeling is definitely worth all of the struggle, I think.
Like a researcher's high.
Yes. The researcher's high is definitely a thing, I think. And I will also echo what Ian said, like, you meet a lot of very, like, very interesting, excellent people, I think. Of course, there's going to be a selection. You people that are in this line of work are probably have some similarities, or the things that I find interesting are maybe more likely to be in other academics. But it's very nice. And the flexibility can be a double-edged sword, but it can definitely be a very positive thing.
That sounds
like
great.
Being able to go to, well, now it's a bit more difficult, but like to sort of the office next door and ask them, oh, like, what are you doing? Or someone in the corridor that seems to be sort of like worried about something, what are you worried about? And then like you go and they explain what they're working on. And many times it's something like really interesting. And to be doing that during, like, as your day job is quite amazing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, spending your time solving interesting puzzles.
Yeah, that does sound like appealing. A good thing to do, yes.
Another positive.
I'm sorry. No, go, Kristin.
Another positive thing, which has not actually been a part of our reality for the last year, but before COVID, traveling was definitely one of academia, like going to conferences or schools or something, or visiting collaborators or something like that. And you manage to, you get to go to places that you might never have gone otherwise. I quite enjoy traveling, which probably you could see with my, it probably explains why I've moved countries multiple times, because I enjoy going to new places.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And sorry, Rose.
No, that was the main thing that came to mind for me as well, Kristin. Yeah, the conferences. I mean, there are many terrifying aspects of conferences for me. They are incredibly anxiety-inducing places. However, it's so nice to be able to travel to different places, that some of which you may have wanted to go to and others were potentially places you would never think to visit, you know? And I don't know, I think there's just also a lot of things that you can get involved in. I mean, there's a lot of things like, you know, public outreach that is a huge umbrella term. I mean, again, there are aspects of it that give me the heebie-jeebies and I would not want to go near at all. But there are some aspects of it that I just think are so rewarding and so exciting. You know, not only do you get to do research for a living and find out new things and hopefully get that researcher's high instead of the minus sign in your code, but then you get to go and talk about it with kids who might be really excited, or, you know, the general public that want to know what you do with your life whilst you also wonder that question. You know, I don't know. I think there are so many things that are positive, but not to say it's all positive, but yeah,
that does sound great. Thank you so much. When the beat kicks in, everything falls into place, and it overpowers me. I can't help but dance. You can try to stop me now, but you won't get the chance. And finally, let's move to the what I call finishing questions. A question, if you mind. Just like, if you had an opportunity that you have now to tell undergraduates that they are thinking or considering a career in academia, what do you think they should know about being a researcher / starting their career? Which is a difficult question. I'm not pretending it's an easy question, but like, is there something?
I think it's important to know from the beginning that your value is not your work's value. Like, you and your work are two separate things, and your self-worth is not dependent on that at all, in the slightest, full stop.
Exactly. I think this is a really, really good point. And it makes it so much easier to go through the days of ending up finding a mistake and a week's worth of calculation or something, if you're able to separate that from your self-worth.
And yeah, it's not easy.
Definitely not easy, but it's important to try to keep that in mind and maybe have a mantra of saying, like, it's okay, I'm still a good person. I'm still, I still have friends and family that depend on me, even though I feel like I'm terrible at calculating right now. And you're probably not that bad. Even if you make mistakes, it's never as bad as you feared in the beginning, I think. But then to add on, like, I think Rose's point is definitely probably the most important thing. But another thing that is important to keep in mind is that you are allowed to have boundaries. And probably a lot of people have heard like toxic stories from academia, like people that have been in research groups with very negative environments. And you often feel like you just have to accept it. Especially if when you are just starting out, this is the only experience you have of academia. And very often you kind of you feel like you have to accept, like, okay, this is what academia is. I guess I have to be working until midnight every day, or else my supervisor gets angry at me or something. If you are in that situation, you're allowed to say no. You're allowed to find another supervisor and move on, or something like that. It's very important to kind of have boundaries for yourself and stand up for yourself and take time to actually be a person outside of your PhD work, which is going to make it a lot easier to then separate your self-worth from your results.
Completely. If the only thing you do is work, then it's very easy to slip into that cycle of the only thing I do is work, and therefore work is equal to my self-worth because that's all I do and that's all I have. And that's an incredibly unhealthy attitude. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think for me, kind of very much echoing that, was like the first word that came to my mind was boundaries, and essentially being able to set boundaries. And I think that will actually help people, whatever career they go in. I think it's to be happy, in a sense. I think that is one of the key things. And I think the other thing maybe is responsibility. So being aware of like what is your responsibility and what isn't your responsibility, and being okay with saying like that isn't my responsibility. And also within that, if something is your responsibility, making sure you have power to carry that out. So if someone's asking you to be responsible for something over which you have no agency, that's not necessarily a fair thing, and may cause quite a lot of stress. So I think just kind of setting boundaries, being aware of what you are not responsible for. I think if you can kind of put those things together, it can help a lot. But also be aware and don't be too hard with yourself. Like, it takes time. Like, saying no is one of the hardest things to do. It's much easier to say yes. And so, like, it will take some time to practice, but even if, like, one skill you take away from a PhD is you become very good at saying no, then that's a very good skill to have and will really help you.
Because mm-hmm. I should say, like, one thing as well, which I'm sure, like, or maybe the others will concur as well. Like, or a thing that I also heard in a panel discussion, celebrate the times that when it goes well and remember those. Especially when it's not going like that, remember, like, you have made, like, progress at some points, and there have been times when things have gone well, and, like, really enjoy them and celebrate.
It's far too easy to go from one project to another. Oh, this thing's finally finished, I'm gonna move on, and not have that moment of celebration. And if you don't have that high, the lows feel a lot more low.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with that. And yeah, like, it can be so easy to forget the things that went well and the things you already know. Like, you learn so many things, but it often feels kind of inconsequential when you look back. It's like, oh yeah, I read this textbook and now I know this thing. It was easy to learn it. But then you hear someone else say something that you haven't read and you're like, wow, they must be so smart knowing this thing. Again, you probably know just as much as them. You just forget the things that you have learned. You forget the positive things you've managed to do. So it's definitely important.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much for your time and all your answers. I really appreciate them. And I hope our listeners will as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
Plenty to edit as well.
Yeah, good luck with that, Veronica.
You've been listening to Insight, the University of St. Andrews Physics Society's podcast. I was your host, Veronica Salako. Thanks to the wonderful academics of St. Andrews. Join us in the future as we learn more of the people making our education. To find out more about the Physics Society and what we do, please find us on Facebook or Instagram, or search for St. Andrews Physics Society for our website. Thanks for listening. Goodbye.
Like, assuming this just doesn't go in their card, but, like, they often say in time management, like, things take, like, twice as long, and this took, as you expect, and it's, like, precisely, so it's just, like, a great example of that.
I can also make you say anything.
No, only if I give you, like, the words. You need to still be able to rearrange it. Who is your biggest inspiration? God, definitely Trump.
Just put on that German swear words.
Those bits should be edited out, just perhaps for clarification.
I realize I shouldn't be sarcastic to you when, like, it's a recorded thing.
Oh, it's fine. Just add it all out. In all the bits where you've grilled me, it's fine.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I'm just so used to that. It's like my second nature now.
We can just laugh. Like, at the end, we can take some laughs and you can just add, mm-hmm. like, put them in.
Hand laughter.
Oh, no, I should have... I should have asked you that as well. Sorry, I wanted to. So what do you call a group of 3 PhD students and 1 postdoc?
A murder. A confusion of three research students and a proper one.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I'd go with that.